there, community. I'm Mandy Murphy, and welcome to another episode of Wolf Tracks. So, just in case you're wondering what Wolf Tracks is, it's our like magazine show that we run through the South Kitsap High School Video Production Program.
That's right, and I'm Herman Meyer, and today we decided to get a little more in-depth with our stories.
That's right, we're going a little more hands-on today, so come check us out and watch us try some new things on this episode of Wolf Tracks.
Now that you're done with your dinner, sitting back in your favorite reclining chair, time for the greatest show on earth. It's Wolf Tracks. It's Wolf Tracks.
Herman, pretty sure that's not fifth position. Try again. No, that's not in the manual. Well, while Herman continues to humiliate himself, why don't you check out some people who are actually good at dancing?
I bet you didn't even know that South Kitsap had a dance team, now did you? But not for long. The 2009-2010 dance team has spent the year working their butts off in order to make a name.
We've been working really hard because we really want to make a name for ourselves, not just for South Kitsap, but for the entire state.
Compared to last year's team, skills, attitude, and overall performances have shown how much work has been put in.
Every year there's the same big names at competition. There's Tumwater, Heritage, Eastlake.
Our goal this year is to become a big contender at state so we can compete with those really difficult teams and make a new name for ourselves.
It's exactly what the South Kitsap Dance team did. At multiple competitions over the season, South Kitsap Dance has received scores up with those big name teams. And at the 2009 annual Heritage competition, South Kitsap took first.
So at Heritage this year, we did really well. We took first place, and I'm not gonna lie, I bawled like a baby, and it was quite embarrassing, but it was probably one of the best experiences of my life.
This year's team has received more trophies than the past 6 years combined. And I guess the big question is how is South Dance going to do at state?
At state this year, South Kitsap is going to do really well, and people are going to finally recognize how hard we worked and how we earned our spots.
Team, we decided that we would commemorate their success in a pretty extreme way.
Extreme? We decided that we would get commemorative SK Dance Team tattoos.
Yeah, but before we do, we thought we'd take a look into the different factors before we get tattoos or even piercings for that matter. Check this out.
The art of tattoos and piercings have been around for many, many years, but why are they so popular? Are they safe and socially accepted in modern society? And where on earth did the crazy idea come from?
Definitely with the Mayans or Incans, they started everything.
Pretty close, but believe it or not, tattoos and piercings were found even further back in time. Otzi the Iceman had tattoos believed to be from a spiritual healing process, as well as pierced ears. Further along, the Mayans and Aztecs used tattoos to show strength, as well as to honor the gods. Roman warriors used piercings to symbolize their courage in battle, and the Japanese believed that ear piercings could fend off the devil. Now, the art has become a nationwide fad among teens and young adults, but what makes them so popular in present culture?
It expresses what they feel.
Describes who you are in a better way instead of telling everybody else, you're kind of just showing them.
I'd feel good about myself. I'd feel like there's just one little thing that makes me different from everyone else.
I think that people get tattoos or piercings for two reasons. One, because it's a fashion. They enjoy it. They think it looks nice. Two, they get it out of rebellion.
It's very apparent the appeals that tattoos and piercings have to the younger generation, but in the real world, many adults aren't too keen.
My first impression is that I don't want them to be with my children. It's just not something that I really like children to have on their bodies.
But will this fad stick? What happens when these inked engaged young men and women go out into the business world?
School's probably acceptable in some other areas. An igloo? I don't
Were piercings not acceptable? I don't know.
I think that it's become socially acceptable to a certain group of individuals. I don't think it's through all the generations socially acceptable.
Whether it's socially acceptable or not, the real concern a person should have when considering this dangerous art are the health risks.
And that's the number one problem is infectious disease, because they put the needle, obviously it vibrates into your skin, and so if you don't have a great sterilizing procedure or they reuse needles, obviously the infection rate goes up. So it really comes down to hygiene of the place you go to. Do they reuse, do they sterilize properly, or do they use disposable?
So if you're interested in this extreme form of self-expression, make sure you think long and hard about modifying your own body before it's too late.
I enjoy them, plan on getting more tattoos, and I've had piercings, so.
If I were to get a tattoo, I want to get music through my fingers, like so.
So after seeing that video about tattoos, I decided to get a temporary one instead.
That's a sticker.
Well, that guy in there was scary.
You cried when he smiled and said hi to you.
Well, he was a really big guy.
Anyways, so you all might be wondering why we're chilling here in a graveyard.
Why are we in a graveyard?
Because this is about as close as we're going to get to our next subject.
Zombies.
Zombies are a reoccurring part of popular culture, more specifically in horror and fantasy-themed entertainment. Zombie folklore originated in early African culture. Some South African communities actually believe that a dead person can be reanimated by a powerful wizard, with the help of psychoactive drugs, of course. The idea of zombies also originated in graveyards. Early theologists believed that burying the dead 6 feet underground with a huge rock on top of their graves will keep the dead from reanimating and haunting the townspeople. Obviously, the zombie archetype has evolved throughout the years. Zombies have been historically stereotyped as slow, mindless, decaying corpses with a hunger for human brains.
I think it's maybe something we can all relate to. They are human, they're not any kind of other monster, and they are back from the dead, which is a really scary concept for people.
Director George A. Romero had reinvented zombies in terms of modern thematics.
As they evolved with at least the George A. Romero series, they've become gradually more smarter.
Through the 90s somewhere, they became like rage-infected zombies, and then they could sprint, and they're like NFL zombies now, and we have no chance.
Directors like Romero use zombies as a metaphor for real-world problems such as the government, bioengineering, slavery, greed, and exploitation.
I mean, I've only been teaching for a year, but it seems like some of our students might be a little bit brain dead, not all there upstairs.
There are many reasons why people like zombie films.
People like being scared, and people like seeing things that are very unlikely to happen, so it's fun to kind of go the extreme, but you know, not worry about when you're driving home at night that there's going to be a zombie in the back of your car.
Well, it's really cheap to make a zombie film, and it's a really easy concept. I think a lot of filmmakers are just keep, you know, knocking out zombie films, and you know, we have no choice but to just keep watching them, and it spreads around in books and different kinds of media, and so we're pretty much brainwashed into enjoying zombie films.
The zombie apocalypse is among us all, either in the form of annual zombie walks or personal experiences.
And one time I was driving home, and in the middle of the street there was this lady, and she was screaming, and she was looking up at the sky, and she was just completely crazy. And I honked my horn, and she didn't notice that I was there. And I thought for a second, maybe this is a zombie?
I will not say I haven't seen a true decaying zombie. I consider that I have a friend or two that could be classified as a zombie when it comes to certain things.
As a makeup artist, I do so many zombie films. I've probably done 20 in the past 3 years. I've done 4 already in the past 4 months.
Zombies are such a huge cultural phenomenon. There's no stopping the zombie apocalypse coming this 2012.
Herman, for the last time, you're not a zombie.
But I'm studying to get in AP classes.
There are plenty of normal people in AP. To gain a better understanding, unlike my zombie friend here, take a look at this.
Why take AP, right?
AP classes. You've heard of them. You've experienced them firsthand or even by word of mouth. Whether it be English or history, economics or chemistry, government, biology, calculus, or statistics, these classes give students a new, challenging way to learn.
AP really helps you become a better person in that it challenges you every day. I think that colleges like to have students that are challenged every day, that they choose those challenges for themselves.
AP classes are simply a faster route to earning college credits while still in high school. Students enrolled in these courses experience higher levels of difficulty in their studies. They are pushed farther and challenged to deeply explore the topic.
I took my first AP class this year as a senior, and obviously I don't regret it. It was hard at first, but it got better as the year went on.
These higher level college-like classes enable students to obtain a broader understanding of the topic of study. This abundance of knowledge carries the individuals through the rest of their high school career and into a college environment as well. The faster pace of the AP courses leaves students with skills such as the ability to work hard and finish tasks quickly with higher quality.
There are some challenges, such as you have to make sure to do your reading every night, otherwise you can get behind really easily.
But if you challenge yourself every day, you become a better person. And if you don't challenge yourself, then life's easier. You're not better off in the end.
I think AP classes kind of benefit not only your social abilities, but they benefit your intellectual and learning abilities because they push you a little more and they challenge you more than a normal class would.
The completion of an AP class is marked with the final AP test. Coming in at $86 per test, this optional exam determines how much a student has learned from the course. Scores on the test range from 1 to 5, 1 being the lowest, 5 the highest. These also determine how much potential college credit a student may receive.
Students who take AP classes generally do well in college, even if they don't do well in the AP class.
At the end of the year, students are left with the satisfaction of getting through tough challenges in these advanced placement classes, and the knowledge that they will be able to battle similar situations later in college and throughout the rest of their lives.
I think AP is a great program for everyone. So, do it.
Quiet. Look at the size of that lamb. Oh, and that ginormous llama. I just want to eat it.
Herman, there's nothing there.
There's nothing there?
Nothing there. Just the barn.
There has to be something there.
I'm pretty sure there's a sheep behind that building.
Oh, I see it. No, nope, that's cotton. For more information on FFA, check out FFA Week.
Do you, oh, you did hit play. Okay, go.
South Kitsap High School, FFA, has been a part of our high school for many years. But the club is more than just farming and raising livestock. Every year, the club celebrates FFA Week, appreciating what they have with staff lounge facts, activities throughout the week, and by thanking their teachers. Every day of the annual week, the club paints and posts a poster in the staff lounge. These facts, accompanied by food, present the staff with facts about agricultural products. They do this every morning so teachers and staff know a little bit about farming products. For example, on Thursday, the team made a poster with a fact on potatoes and accompanied it with some potato chips. On Thursday, they met in the SK stage to celebrate Green Hand Night, a night of welcoming the new members.
Green Hand Night is about honoring our newest members. It's a very important night in the FFA because as new members come in, we like to honor them for all the hard work that they've done and all the hard work that they're going to get to do by being an FFA.
Green Hand Night also honors higher level members within the chapter, including chapter degree recipients and state degree recipients.
In FFA, when you achieve one of these levels, you get a pin. For Green Hand, you get a bronze pin. For your chapter degree, you get a silver pin. And for your state degree, you get a gold pin.
To seal the deal at the end of the ceremony, each Green Hand recipient paints their hand green and slaps it up on a poster to remember the night.
To wrap up the whole week, every member got to school on Friday at 4:45 in the morning to cook a staff breakfast.
So this morning, I got to school, and there were some signs up all over the school asking the staff members to come down and have breakfast with the FFA students. So apparently the students got up at like 3:30 in the morning, came in and cooked eggs and sausage and pancakes, and there was apples and orange juice, and you know, it was a really neat way for them to say thank you to the staff members, to show their appreciation. When we got down there, you know, they were all kind of lined up, and you know, it was almost like cheerleaders at a football game. It was great.
It's at the end of our FFA week, which we do to celebrate FFA, and they do it as kind of the end culminating things.
Being more than just farming and raising livestock, the team shows others what they have with farming facts, welcomes the new members, and wraps up the week with thanking those who support them. The club had a great time this year and cannot wait to do it again next year.
So, we figured out that animals, they really aren't our thing either.
No, but neither is cyberbullying.
So, to learn more about this serious epidemic taking society by storm, take a look at this.
Cyberbullying. We've all heard about it. Every single day, more stories of real-life consequences happening in our school show up in newspapers around the world. I talked to some of the students here at South Kitsap, and the results were staggering.
I think the basic name-calling, that can happen like anytime.
I have been cyberbullied, unfortunately, and it's not fun. It's actually a big problem for a lot of teenagers and a lot of kids nowadays.
They say things, they basically attack.
I actually have a lot of friends who get cyberbullied.
Yes, I do. I have a lot of friends that have been cyberbullied.
Probably anyone could say that they've been cyberbullied through texting.
Yeah, I have. And I know that a lot of my friends have too. It's a huge issue.
And the students of South are not alone. A 2004 study found that 58% of kids say they've been harassed online. 53% admit to having harassed someone online, and 35% of students say they've been threatened online. The effects of this kind of peer abuse have been well documented. Victims of cyberbullying can suffer from depression, increased suicidal ideation, loss of self-esteem, and a tendency to avoid new friendships and activities. Additionally, an alarmingly high number of cyberbullying incidents have led to acts of real-life violence, many of which have been posted on sites like YouTube in the form of home recordings like this one. Worse still, the fact that children often are reluctant to relate these problems to adults has led to fatal outcomes. At least 3 children between the ages of 12 and 13 have committed suicide as a result of cyberbullying. But it's not always easy to tell if this kind of harassment is what leads to someone's suicide. There could be countless cases of harassment-induced suicide out there that have gone undocumented. And with the rise of devices like cell phones, portable gaming devices, media players, and newer technology like the iPad, it has never been easier for someone to attack another person anonymously. It doesn't help that most adult figures are powerless to both recognize the problem and to combat it without legal action.
I don't know that it's a serious problem here.
Nope, I've never had a kid tell me about that.
Media has made it aware to us. I really don't know how serious of a problem it is.
I'm sure there's some nasty stuff out there that's going on.
I'm sure it exists, but you know, it's really, you know, it's out there in that cyberspace area.
And in most cases, the ability to combat the problem directly tends to fall way outside of the school's power.
If it's something that starts off campus and comes onto campus, then we obviously have it to deal with it, and we do deal with it. But if it's strictly happening outside in the community, it's really outside the purview of what we do as a school system.
One of the more recent and popular methods of anonymous internet contact is a website called Formspring. Following in the well-established footsteps of social networking sites like MySpace, Facebook, and Twitter, Formspring's premise is simple. Users create a page that serves as a virtual billboard where other people can ask the user questions and then he or she can post the answers on the page. The premise is innocent enough, but it is so easily abused that it has quickly jumped to the forefront of internet harassment technology and is beginning to afflict our school. An anonymous user of Formspring has recently created a page entitled SK's Dirty Laundry that simply calls upon South students to post anything and everything about anyone and everyone. While not necessarily sinister by itself, the page has erupted in popularity and notoriety, nearing almost 2,000 messages worth of spiteful messages, rumors, and controversial remarks in just a few weeks. The feedback from the student body has been as nebulous as the site itself.
And I think it's just completely ridiculous.
Yeah, I actually follow it and check it every day.
I find it really interesting, and it's a lot like Gossip Girl, which I love, so for me it's amusing.
I think SK Dirty Laundry is, I think it's pretty cool.
I think SK Dirty Laundry is disgusting.
Whoever created it should be ashamed of themselves, honestly.
I think it's pretty funny. It seems pretty harmless.
SK Dirty Laundry is probably like the stupidest thing I've ever heard of.
After propositioning the creator of the page, dubbed the Laundry Man by many students, for an interview, I received this letter stating his purpose that reads,
I'm not doing anything. All I'm doing is providing a blank slate. It's people that are doing this to themselves, and that, above all, is my point. Everyone is just so nice and supportive of each person, but they're all two-faced. I guess what I really want is for people to get back to basics. Stop pretending to be good people and just actually make an attempt to be a good person.
Malicious or justified? You decide. But how legal is all this? What can be done? What is being done?
I think the only thing that could really change the problem is not having internet.
I don't really think there's any way you can really change it, because a lot of times you can't even tell who's doing it.
You're never going to have the people who stop thinking they're better than other people. It's just not going to happen.
So I think the only thing that can really be changed is not to open doors for yourself. If there's someone you don't want to talk to, don't message them back. If they message you, don't say anything back, because the minute you message them back, it's just opening another door to fight.
It just comes down to, we need to say no. We need to say that this is something that we're not going to tolerate. And when we don't tolerate it ourselves, it will start to run rampant and people will stop doing it.
But at the end of the day, cyberbullying is a serious problem with no real solutions. The internet isn't creating any new problem. It's just expanding on a problem that was already there, human hatred. And that's a problem we may never be able to solve.
So our next story that we have here for you is about bungee jumping. So I will be jumping out this window.
That is false, Mandy. This is the end of our show.
Have a great day.
Have a great day.
But I don't need to be reminded a change is gonna come. I can feel it on the tip of your tongue. And I feel alive, I feel alive. We married plus we settled the sun. Between the heat and the work week, the fevers we could use some sleep. Sleep to the superfluous man was better used to beds in our bed. I'm coming home alone tonight. This is how it was. I moved on. I passed a billboard down the block. It asked if I had enough, and allowed to say I had too much, when the truth is I'm just getting started. Now the bar lights are blinking in time to Mexican music. It's dawning the pain.